This is Kari Payton, and you're listening to Three Black Geeks. So keep on listening, because they're going to keep on talking.
Hey, what's going on, folks? We're back again talking about American Gods. Joining me today, D's here. How's it going, man?
As always.
Boy Crosby, he's back at it. It's like the third in a row, actually.
Wow, I know, right? Feeling so great.
I gotta say, I'm pretty sure I'm probably not the only person here that never read the American Gods book. I mean, I thumbed through it, but I never, like, read it. I mean, I'm guessing, have y'all read it, or y'all probably never even read it at all?
Yeah, I read it.
I knew it was a book. I knew it was, I hate to say, famous is a little bit too much of big of a word. I knew it was a bestseller. I knew of its presence. Much sort of like the story of Fire and Ice, like Game of Thrones, I knew it existed. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Let's put it that way.
Yeah. What about you, Crosby?
Oh, I read the book. I'm also reading the comic.
Mm-hmm.
So
now, who makes the comic? I have no idea who does that.
It's done by Dark Horse, but it's still Neil Gaiman's American Gods.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
Neil Gaiman.
and does Neil, is he like a writer on that one too, or is it like, you know,
they give it a, how do I say it? Like maybe the produce, like, you know, the main writer.
Okay.
Because they're taking his story already. He's okay. Not the main writer. They're taking his story, and someone else is just writing the words on the comic. So he's involved, I'll say, but it's not as much. I think he's more involved on the show side.
Yeah.
I gotta say,
it didn't really, like, when all of it came out that they was gonna have a TV show of it, not to say I was a flocking to it. Nobody, you know, like usual, let's just be real. Let's not try to, you know, be fake about it. If you don't know about the book, you didn't know about the book. When you heard the announcement of the show coming out, you didn't give a crap until you saw the actual trailer to the show and you were like, what the hell is going on?
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
I hate people like, oh, man, I was waiting for the show. No, you wasn't.
right.
Yeah, I think people, I mean, and it's, you know what? It's funny. It's nothing wrong if you weren't like expecting the show. It's just like you said. It's like, hey, don't say that you were expecting this. It's like me saying, like the new Castlevania show just dropped, right? And I was one of those people that was like, I never was like, oh my god, I knew they were gonna make it. I was like, I figured it was either, I figured a live action movie was gonna happen before we got an animated show on Netflix. That's probably the only thing I expected.
That being said, I haven't seen nothing about that yet. Is Konami a part of it?
Just in name only, since they actually, you know, made the property, but that's about it.
Are you sure? Because I can still say fuck Konami and not watch it, and I'd be happy.
I mean, it's kind of like
watch it either.
Yeah, I mean, it's 20 minutes per episode, only 4 episodes, so there you go.
I gotta see it. I don't know why I haven't seen that.
But it's amazing, though, how everybody even watched that, and they're still like, oh, this shit fire, and all that crap. You know, which I'm sure it is. But
spoiler alert, that Castlevania show is just basically Dracula 3, Dracula's Curse, the game, just in animated form. So it's like, I mean, now if you're familiar, like we've all played, I mean, me and you have played the Castlevania game. So like when I watched the show, I was like, oh, this is Dracula 3, this is Castlevania 3, which I'm fine with. I was actually, I love they actually added a little bit more lore to the game and stuff. But, you know, for people that maybe not knowing it, you know, that's why a lot of people were like, oh my God, it's the greatest thing ever, you know, so.
And of course, you know, real talk, you know, it's just only super nerds like me who know what's going on over there at Konami, where it's like, no, I'm not, I'm boycotting it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
Of course. So, you know, that's two different things. That's two different things, though.
Now,
but when it comes to, like, the release of one of these shows, especially when it's a book written before the show comes out, that's the one thing a lot of people, I think we expect, but we don't expect, is like, oh, what comic this came from? What novel this came from? Mm-hmm. And I think people, we just come, you know, that just comes to a second nature, thinking that because this show is either going to be too good, or you got these influx of fans that are like, oh my God, you don't know nothing about it. You know, that shit happens all the time. So with American Gods was different for me. I don't know about you two, but I saw the preview. I was like, what the hell is going on here?
Oh yeah,
you know what I mean?
Because
the first thing I saw was Ian McShane, and I just got to be honest with you. I had a hard on, and I wanted to watch the show. So that's just me.
I mean, listen, you know, for those that listen to our show,
sitting down eating a McDonald's menu, and I'd be like, "Yo, y'all see this fascinating shit?"
Though, he could do that. Like, I mean, Ian McShane is just that dude.
He's my boy, man. I like him ever since. The first thing I really liked him in was Deadwood, and I was I was a huge fan of that, and they canceled it, and I was so mad. I know they did something to like make you feel better. So I think they made something. I don't know, but I've been a fan of Ian McShane since then. I mean, so
Deadwood
I was ready
for me. But I think the running joke that we have is Ian McShane and Kung Fu Panda when he was like, "So that is his name."
You and DJ Sue love that joke, man. To me, it's like, shut up, stop mocking him. This man is a Shakespearean actor. I mean, he does not have to take
it. It's like when you watch that movie, right? It's like, you know, a lot of great voice talent that they got for it. And it's like Ian McShane playing the bad guy. It fit, and it's just like he cheesed it up, and it was the good kind of cheese. I loved it.
Even when he was on Deadwood, the only reason I think we all like Deadwood was because during that time in the 2000s where cursing was still a cool thing.
Yeah.
Everything was fucking, damn it, bastard, you know, bitch, all the rest of that. You know what? You know why I think Ian McShane is the man? Because in Deadwood, there was a scene where he was getting head from this big girl, and he was monologuing. Straight up monologuing. And here's the best part. He bust a nut, but you didn't know he did. Nobody knew he did. Because he didn't give no indication of or none of that. He did nothing. He was just done. And he was like, he looked at the big girl. He's like, "You did a good job. Now get the fuck out of my face," or something like that. You know what I mean? I'm like, this dude is amazing. Why he's not won anything? And then Wikipedia came out like a year later. I was like, oh shit, he has.
Now, his thing about American Gods, right? I was one of those people. Now, the first episode, I didn't catch it until maybe 20 minutes in, because I was like, I forgot what I was watching. That's why Into the Badlands. So I didn't catch. I think I caught the second showing of it when they had on Stars and stuff, because I got Amazon Prime. It was a free weekend because American Gods is coming out that weekend for Stars, so cable or whatever puts it out for free. So I came in on the Goddess Biscuit literally sucking a dude in her vagina, and I was like, what the fuck
soul
did
snatching?
I just watch?
You just watched the literal, the visual representation of soul snatching.
I mean... Yeah. I was like, because she was all telling the dude, like, worship me, and then he got small. I'm like, what the fuck is going on? And then, bam, he's up in her snatch, and I'm like, okay, what did I just watch? What is this?
My wife asked me, he's like, was that sex? My wife would look at me like, wow, so what was that? I'm like, I tell you what it is. Somebody just had the weirdest jerk-off session ever. That's what happened.
No, because...
But yeah, that was, to me... that's what the show's that's what makes this show so awesome. It's the visuals. It makes it so, because the fact that, and when you was watching it, well, y'all like me is like, hey, why is she getting bigger? What's going on? Wait a minute. Why is he going? Oh my gosh, she just tucked that dude inside of her. What just
happened? Hey. You know what's funnier is, okay, so if, because I read the book, so in that scene when they're describing what she's doing to him.
Yeah.
And this is why I like the show. This is why I think, to me, this is one of the best, amongst the best TV show to, book to TV or book to movie translations, is because what the visuals did and how the visuals captured that moment, or most of the moments in this movie, in the show, is literally when they're describing that scene and she's getting bigger and he's getting smaller, it's like they lifted the words off the page and threw it on, like put it in on the screen.
I understand.
Like, and then the best part about it is the comics also follow in line with the book. Like, literally, the comics are literally the book, but with illustration. So if you've never read the book and you want to, catch up on American Gods and what's going on, pick up one of the comics. The only thing is the comics go into a little more detail. You know how if you're translating book to, it's a book to a different form of media, things get lost, or things, you have to translate things a different way.
Yeah.
So where, and on the show, some things get lost and you can't see it. The comics give you illustration, so you can actually see those pictures. And then, in the comic book, that scene is in the comic book, which is crazy. It's why I love Dark Horse or, Image, because they go places that Marvel and DC won't go.
Of course.
Seriously.
Dark Horse is really known for that, and that's what should be really praised about Dark Horse, too.
Oh yeah, definitely. So grand summation of American Gods is basically old gods versus new gods.
Pretty much.
Basically.
And how deep, and because I like this is real, I'm Christian. I really don't celebrate the religion like that. I really don't. I'm more spiritual than anything else. But it's that, and then it's a combination of not just what you believe in and what you're all that. It's God, I'm trying to figure out what I was trying to say. It's basically, put it this way, is that like I like Greek mythology too. It almost goes into that. So when it comes to all the gods that you're seeing, you're like, okay, what is their purpose? What are they doing? What are they in it for? Especially when you finally realize it's old versus new.
Mm-hmm.
The way they try to integrate that into American life. And that's where it gets, and that's the really the best part about it. How does that God look in American life today?
And the thing of it is, they go across the spectrum, because it isn't just like us American guys. There's like Egyptian guys. Like, you get Anubis in there. You get
a guy
like Orlando Jones plays Mr. Nancy. He's the Ganon trickster.
You
got Easter, who she's the Germanic. She's like a German god.
She's Germanic.
She's
Germanic, but she's the solstice god. She's solstice.
Yeah, and then you had Chernobog, which is
He's a god of death.
Yes. And that's why you see his job, the job he's in, he's doing right now, killing cows. That's literally what he does. That's his job.
Yeah.
Yeah, granted I was smoking weed when I was looking at it, but I was trying to get deep.
Yo, that episode had me tripping.
Son, because not because of the hand, because I thought a little bit too hard with that. When I saw him, I'm like, well, he's in Chicago. And I automatically say either he's a god of war or he's a god of death. Why Chicago? Chicago? And I said this. Yeah, because of Chicago.
That's funny, because I never even thought about that. He's in Chicago, like, just taking it away from the literal, representation. Like, Chicago really is, like, what Chicago is, or what the media portrays Chicago to be.
Yeah, exactly. It's this very violent place.
And then the show, last episode, they dared to do it. We get Jesus, or at least one of many versions of Jesus.
Oh, and that right there is the reason. Like, it was so funny. My wife my wife is really big on don't celebrate Easter. Yeah. My wife is huge on that. Don't celebrate Easter. Because, and I'm, you know, me just marrying her, like, God, for the love of God, baby, blah, 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 blah. It's like, no. This is all the eggs, that's for fertility, D. Like, what? It's like, no, that has nothing to do with Jesus. Yeah. Like,
Easter was never a Christian holiday.
Exactly. She said that. That's never a Christian holiday. She went on me, like, D, you don't even believe that Jesus was born on Christmas. I'm like, hell no, he wasn't born on Christmas. So you just going to tell, and she's like, so you're just going to tell me you want to believe that Easter, and be like, oh my God, it has nothing to do with it, does it?
I mean, that's the funny thing is, I don't know whether, and I think Kevin Smith mentioned that in Dogma, one of his characters mentioned that, and it's like, how is it that, you know, you look at the Bible description of when Jesus was born, nothing about it feels as though it happened in a December or on Christmas and stuff, where we feel not at the all. Snow and all that stuff. And it's like, wow, this is drastically different. It's like, I don't know who picked up on Christmas is where we celebrate Jesus' birth. I don't know when it started.
Basically, and you see Easter, basically, that's where it happened, because the pagans worship during always worship solstice, and there you go, you see her. Easter just became hey, that's when we celebrate Jesus' death, because, you know, we got all these pagans out here celebrating. How dare they celebrate spring? Ugh. Gay wads. Let's say Jesus did. This is what Jesus died. Just to counterbalance.
Okay, I'm sorry. Go ahead. One of the other great things about this show is that, yes, you have old gods versus new gods, but then it shows you the human casualties in between. Like, take Bill Keys, for example. Like, she's literally killing people so she can sustain her life.
Oh, yeah.
Or Wednesday and Dead Wife. Like, the whole reason, you know, he needed Shadow, or he needed to get Shadow was, or the whole way he got Shadow, you know, how messed up that was.
Yeah.
You know, when we found out. Oh, and
we're so spoiling, by the way, then, so you don't have to, like, necessarily, like, you
know. Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, so I can, like, go ahead, dude, and, I can go ahead and describe it.
The season's already over with, dude. Yeah, they, right. Look, you don't know. They're just here to talk. Look, people are here to listen to us and talk about all the funny, all the great parts, and hopefully get a good joke out of one of us when it comes
to this. If you didn't know this, Wednesday had Dead Wife killed. Or not Dead Wife. Her name is Laura Moon. He had Laura killed so that he could get Shadow. So, you know, like, there's human casualties in this war, gods versus gods. But, you know, we're not even looking at that. You know, the spectacle of the gods is what is being shown, and that's what everyone is seeing. But there's a majority of human casualties. Like, as sexy as it is, you remember, I think, in the second episode when they were showing Bill Keys, and she was just snatching soul after soul after soul, and she's equal, and she's an equal opportunity employer, because she was male and female. And when we all saw that, it was good to look at, but you're thinking to yourself, people are actually, like, people are dying. Like, I just thought they were going to
get a good night of sex and go home. And it's like, oh, you're done. Sorry.
It's one of the things I picked up when I was in high school. And even when God of War came out, and I actually looked up the Greek gods, I had to look it up. Human life, like you said, it just gets used. Gods use human beings, period. Whether it's for good or for evil. Yeah. They use them. They're nothing more, like I said, casual. They used to be the casualty of man and all that. And one of a good example is probably everybody's favorite, at least black people's favorite scene in the whole show so far, when Nancy was on the ship, telling them telling them about American, black American life, and one of the slaves was just straight up like, "But won't we die? Fool, you already did. You might as well die for a reason."
Right.
Yeah.
That, like, happens all
the time. Nigga, what?
And there was a line that even Wednesday told Shadow, which is deep as hell, which I love. It's probably one of the best lines in the whole show to me, where he was, where, you know, he's still trying to get Shadow to freaking believe in what he's doing. And real talk, that's me right now in my life. Don't ask questions. He's trying to get him to believe, like, believe. It's like, so how many people need to believe in a god? And Wednesday say just one.
Oh yeah, and it
don't take much. It don't take much for a god to be a god. If that person's a god,
that's it.
They have that's all the power that god needs, and that's the whole point of Wednesday doing all this to shadow in this first season. It was just basically
to believe that Odin exists.
Exists.
Man, that Odin scene was kind of tough. It was great to see Wednesday finally like show power, because I mean, we had seen Chernabog's power, we had seen we hadn't seen Easter yet. We had seen
Sweeney's powers in the first episode.
Yo,
Sweeney deals me because
Sweeney is my dude. Matter of fact, we even saw the Jin's power.
All right, look, real talk. Me personally, proud of myself. That is the second gay sex scene I've seen, and I did not pop a boner. I am so proud of
myself. Man, listen. I don't know whether D put it up on our Twitter handle or his Twitter handle, and I had to agree with him. He was like, look, there are going to be some racist white people that are going to feel some sort of way at that scene. I don't fucking care. That shit was fucking awesome.
No, I'm not even going to lie to you. That shit was awesome. And what made it even more awesome was when they went into the 3D, the animated showing of when he, climaxed.
Yeah.
But here's me. I had to ask my wife. Hey, man, so gay dudes can do it like that? I didn't know that.
Like, the more you know, it's just all of a sudden your head explodes and shit. Like, oh my God.
I didn't know how to feel about it. I look at my wife and her girlfriend. I'm like, what do y'all think? That shit was hot. I'm like, what?
Hey, man. Kudos to whoever directed that episode, because that's the thing that if a lesser director, it wouldn't have had that impact and stuff.
Oh, yeah. You would have ducked that mainly because
it
would
have been on some odd shit where it's like, okay, that was a little awkward.
I think you also ducked it because, you know, the whole thing about Jen, that is Islam, and that is a hot button topic for a lot of people.
Oh yeah,
and you know I'm pretty sure that a lot of Muslim people saw that episode and were like, "Fuck this flipped. Show, I'm done."
They had to flip.
I'm pretty damn sure.
Funny,
but you know what?
You know what? As somebody that was on Twitter, it was split because there was it's a couple people that we followed that are Muslim, and it was like, you know what? I appreciate that show for actually doing that scene. And there were some people that were retweeting some Muslims that were feeling some sort of way about this scene. It was split.
Because, you know, I hate to be that person too, but Islam, the way it is today, isn't the way it was 2,000 years ago.
Same thing go
for Christianity. Not even so much being progressive, but a lot was lost. A lot was lost. A lot was changed. A lot of people got corrupt. Like Saudi Arabia, the sheikhs basically changed the whole religion to the way it is today. Yeah. Much like the Catholic Church changed what happened in the Christian faith. So yes, money, people got involved and twisted up the whole thing and all the rest of that. That happens. Mm-hmm. That's one of those things that happens. So when you do a scene like this that kind of bucks at least the current tradition, hell yeah, it's gonna get somebody to. I looked at it the whole time. I was like, yo, I know there's a nigga named Rashid right now that is getting liberated watching this, but I know there's a nigga named Sadiq that is ready to blow up everything because of this.
Like, fuck this show. Like,
this show went there a lot of times.
Even with the Christian faith, they went there.
Man,
they
listen, when they had Jesus in the last episode, I was sitting back, okay, dude, there is somebody in this world that was watching American Gods and they were with the show, and then they put Jesus in there. It was like, how dare this show put Jesus here?
No. Before that, I think episode 7, Sweeney's episode, when they showed Mexican Jesus crossing the fucking border.
Yeah, man. Yeah. Shit.
Dude, this nigga crossed the border and got shot. And did you see how he died?
Yeah.
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 Young. I was like, This like the visuals of this show, like Jesus dying for his people on the cross, like he was crossed out. I was like, yo, yeah.
It feels like there's more to Jesus. It feels like there's more to Jesus' story because there was a line actually said earlier from Wednesday.
Head full of snow.
Huh?
Head full of snow, right?
Yeah.
I think what he said. He said He said, "Well, yeah, you got the different Jesus. You got your black Jesus. You got your North African Jesus. You got your you got your Judo Christian Jesus, you got your European Jesus. And Shadow said, hey, why there's so many Jesuses? And Wednesday said, again, one of the best lines, because the world needs Jesus.
He has a point. Hey, look, man, we joke about that joke in 21 Jump Street. He was like, hey, stop fucking with Korean Jesus. But hey, dog.
Hey, Korean Jesus. These Korean Jesus.
Didn't they have an Asian Jesus in the Easter episode?
I think so. Yes, they
had at least 10 different Jesuses. Yeah, because you remember when Shadow was at the pool talking to one of the Jesus?
One of them was Asian.
And then, there was a lot. Yo, this show, to me, besides the visuals, had a lot of very, like, you know, you had to watch it to grab some other things besides the visuals. And then just some representations, like, especially with Nancy's episode, you know, his breakout episode when he's on the ship.
Yeah.
And this guy, first of all, I have to commend whoever directed that episode. I have to commend them. I have to commend the acting coach, the language coach, whatever, because I'm the train. And that Igbo that dude spoke on that ship, that was like dead ass correct. Oh, that was 100% correct. So when I was watching that, first of all, I have to stop it and rewind it because I really didn't. I was like, wait a minute. Is this? Hold on. And then I played it right back. But what I appreciate out that episode is, yes, they didn't force Orlando to speak. You know, they didn't force him to have an African accent. They didn't force him to, you know, to change his demeanor or his speak. They kept it, you know.
It works like a Green Lantern ring. Put it that way. I'm a god. You're going to understand me no matter what.
Exactly. Yeah. And you saw the faces of the people on the boat looking at him. They were looking at him like, I know exactly what you're saying. And they'd speak
and
to
I
him.
And I know who you are. And I know who you are.
And they'd speak to him in their language, and he'd reply in English, and they'd understand.
Mm-hmm. But and that's one of the things that I learned as a kid. I learned as a kid being in church. They say, you know that when you see it.
Right.
So, and that was one of those examples. You know God when you see him.
You see him. Pretty much. I mean, forget that he came in one of the freshest suits, like the three-piece fresh.
Man, this like, nigga came on this ship.
Yo, I'm not going to lie. They had the black people looking good on this show.
Yeah. Because
Anubis, Jackie L, Bill Kreese,
I mean,
Orlando. Even Shadow sometimes. They had him looking. They didn't have no black bun. I got to, except for maybe. I'm sorry. Did I just do that? Did I go there?
Yeah, you did.
No, you didn't go there. No, you good, man. You good.
I haven't really gone there yet. No, except for the one episode where they show Bill Kreese, she had lost her powers and came down to 2013.
Which was interesting to me. I got where they were going with that.
Mm-hmm.
But I was like, why did she lose power? Because to me, sex is sex. Is it because they're not worshiping her? Is that the reason?
I think that's what it is. Because people, I mean, think about it. People had started, like, because before all that, people were having sex and throwing these sex parties. And she was throwing these sex parties and having sex with people.
Mm-hmm.
But in my opinion, this is the way I look at it. What happened is, when it all happened, is people started looking at their computers more. You know, now we're watching porn.
I think that's why homeboy gave her that whole Tinder,
put her on Tinder.
Yeah,
and now that's how so instead of us like going to parties, meeting people and having sex at parties like they did in the 70s and then back in the day, we're now oh hey, swipe right, swipe left.
Mm-hmm. Hey man, look, man, you can't be too
watching
sure.
Porn.
Hey man, sure, man. AIDS is serious.
Hey, you know what, man? That was another thing I was factoring in, too. I was like, maybe because, AIDS was a thing that popped up in the 80s.
I got the reason. See, that was cool to me. I got the reason why she got out the Middle East because, what I just said earlier, a lot of Islam, a lot of that religion was changing during that time, especially during the 1950s, where women were getting shut down left and right.
Right.
So her getting out of wherever she was, I'm like, that can't be Middle Eastern. She got to be more North African. But even still, a lot of wars and a lot of things tore up all of that section. You know what I mean? Religion changed. The way the religion changed. Hell, even in a deep way, the way women were viewed changed up during that time, too.
Mm-hmm.
So,
because I think women were worshipped earlier. Oh, yeah. I want to think that. I just want to think because...
that's one of that pisses me off about Hotep dudes. They be the first one called Black Girls Queens, where it's like, you do realize, then like, nah, they supposed to be subservient. This stuff, like, you do realize that we used to worship women, right?
Yes.
Yep. Like,
yes.
Worship women, right? Now I can't do that because it's like a pussy thing. Like, wait a minute, dude, what you, like, see, and there you go. Man corrupting what the religion is supposed to have been in the fucking first place. That's okay. That happened.
And that's why, you know, again, I don't want to go there, but I think I might. And that's why you look at, you know, what is written in the Bible, or you look at what's written, you know, wherever it's written on history. And what is happening is they've tried their best to tone down the woman in everything. The woman is always second. If you notice in most of the Bible, when they're describing the lineage of a man or of a family, they hardly ever talk about his, you know, female daughters or children. It's always Joseph sired this person sired this person. Didn't he have daughters? Like, what's going on? All those people siring, those people like giving birth to these people, like, you know, women became secondary. And I think that's in turn, it affected Bill Kreese. Like, there's a lot of like imagery and just a lot of things you can grab from it. And it's how she lost the powers. And they tore down her temple. Yeah, they tore down her temple.
Yeah, and come on, that kills you off right there. You know?
And I think when she saw it, that's, she just got depressed and she was done. She may have had AIDS.
She may have.
Oh no!
I mean, but God is probably not going to, you know, affect you as much. So now the way she and you know what makes that episode even more important is when you go back to, I think, two episodes before that, the Vulcan episode. The Vulcan episodes when
God,
you know,
we're gonna talk about him next in a second. Don't worry. Go ahead.
Yeah,
I'm sorry. When we find out that, you know, not even the Vulcan episode, the episode before the Vulcan episode, when we find out, when we actually finally see Mr. World, and we see Media's power. I love Media, by the way.
I was in love with
Karen Gillian.
Set up all three of them. I love how they set up all three of them. Gillian Anderson, yeah. Good God.
Oh, my
she
God.
She needs to get something off of this crap she's doing.
I was trying to have sex with her when I was watching the episodes.
This is the same one from X-Files? This Gillian Anderson? Wow.
She don't even look like that, bro. Like, what?
Okay, when I saw her as, first off, don't know how to clap hard enough and loud enough for that. That the first image that she was Lucy, was Lucille Ball. Yeah, I do not know where to begin to say perfect. I don't know where to start. Then you see her again. She's Marilyn Monroe.
She said, you want to see Lucy's tits.
I was like, no, but I think I do now.
In color.
I've never thought Lucy was sexy. I don't know why.
Only thing that comes to Lucy, what I loved about Lucille Ball is because when you look at it, she was the bitch, man. She was that chick. She did amazing stuff for everybody in television, man. So yeah, of course I got the idea. Like, you're gonna have the representation of television. It'll be her. I like the fact that you see her later on, she's dressed up as David Bowie.
Yeah.
Wow, interesting. Do you see her again? She's dressed up like Marilyn Monroe.
That was when I wanted to have sex with her. I'm sorry. You were saying?
This made it so funny. Then you see, of course, technology. Technology is the youngest one of all.
Yeah, and you can tell. You can tell he's a douche. Like, he's a young guy. He's a young IT guy. Like, I love the representation of tech, you know, like, because most young people with technology are douches. Like, have you ever gone into the Apple store and tried to talk to someone and that guy's just looking at you or talking to you like you're an idiot? I'm like, dude, I actually know what I'm doing, but okay, sell me the iPhone, I guess.
Yeah. That was what technology rules all.
Where technology rules all. Yeah, he's young.
And he's smoking his little vape.
Electronic cigarette.
Cigarette. Well, just take also.
From a dude that smokes, I respect bands, I really do. Here's the problem. There's something non-lethal about it that makes it so bad. It's because it can't kill you, and that's probably why I don't like it. That's why I'm like, nah, I can't taste the cancer.
It's like, I need that cancer. I need it.
You said, I can't taste the cancer.
I can't taste the cancer, bro. Like, but anyway.
No, but what I love really made me... Go ahead.
And I love if you notice anything else, if you've noticed down to the music he listens to and everything, his music is dubstep, which is the epitome of technology, in my opinion.
Yeah, exactly.
So I love that, because the first thing I heard a little wah, we're like, okay, this is going to be cool as shit.
I mean, the first episode when he's killing Shadow, and he puts, first off, he has a fucking damn media box that just attaches itself to Shadow's head, and he just gets transported there, which I thought was actually pretty interesting. But just he's on this, it looks like he's in a.
And the first time I seen him, I was like, he's probably a god of technology? Nah, he can't be. And I was right. I was like, yeah, I knew it.
I mean, and just like he's in the, it looks like a limousine. Might as well say it looks like a limousine he's in, but he just talked to him. Just, it's all bright colored and stuff in there. And it's like, okay, this is like, you know, a Shadow. And again, early episode, Shadow is just trying to figure out what the fuck is going on. And again, this is the very first episode you're coming from. He's dealing with a leprechaun that's not really the typical leprechaun that we know, because he's
that we know, you know, your terms.
You know, he thinks the leprechaun is delicious. Just, yeah, he thinks this leprechaun is just some dude that just knows some parlor tricks and whatever. And you know, he's dealing with Wednesday, who's just like, oh, work for me. And so already up to this point, Shadow's like, fuck, okay, maybe I'm just tripping. What drugs did I take? And then bam, he's with Technical Boy. And then all of a sudden, Technical Boy has these dudes kicking the shit out of him. About the
man, he had the EDM putty patrol show up. Yo, son.
Like, what's dope about that episode is you're listening to Daft Punk or whoever they had playing while getting your ass whooped, and it's a great look, because it's like what I took from that episode is, like, no matter how hard this man is trying to get his life in order, like, nothing he can do, everything is getting him down. Technology is failing him. Like, he can't find his way in this life. Like, all he wants to do is bury his wife. Yo, let me not talk about how I feel about that woman yet, because I don't want to sound like that I hate women type nigga, because
let's just be real. Let's just be very real about
fuck her.
Fuck her. Twice. That ass.
Like, seriously.
So, alright, let me get one thing out the way, though. I will say this, and me and Chris talked about it. Yeah, we were right. That was only one movie for Emily Browning for her. That was only one movie for her that she looked halfway good for us. Okay, cool. it was so funny because a couple years ago, we actually did Sucker Punch. And I did ask the question. I'm like, well, Emily Browning, I knew I had to be real with her. She's a decent actress. I have no problem with her. And even in this show, I think she's pretty damn good. But, you know, we was like, you know, is she like, man, do you care for her? Nah, not really.
So, yeah, but I didn't care for, like, of all the characters, I didn't care for her character at all.
I
loved Audrey.
Which one? Who was that again?
Her best friend.
Oh yeah, yeah.
I would have let Audrey suck me off in the grave.
Shadow had a conscience.
Like, she said, "Let me suck you off and come in my mouth." Like, language. I don't want to sound like, you know, Captain America right now, but the language on this show. She says, come in my mouth, I'm going to spit it on his grave.
Spit it on his grave. I was like, you know what, son? If I did that to my wife, she's in the right. She's in the right. But here's the funny part about it. Now, I remember she said, when she's like, oh, you don't know. She said, you don't know. Like, yeah, she was
in the fucking church.
In the, I'm like, yo,
and like loud as fuck in the church.
Yeah, your wife was found with my husband's dick in her mouth. Yeah,
yeah. Everything stopped. Even the keyboard, the organ goes on.
Organ boy, like, man. You know, I don't know how. Look, if I was a pastor, I don't even know how you do that. All right, y'all, come up here and say goodbye to this hoe. what do you want me to say at that point?
It's like, she said,
at that point.
And Audrey's a bastard, because she said, I almost let them just bury her with it.
I would have been, look, she's within every right of how she felt. Yeah, like I said, if that was my wife and I found out she was sucking my best friend's dick, I'd be like, no, keep it in there. And matter of fact, when everybody walks up, have it halfway open so they can see it a little bit. I don't care. I just got my heart broken. Now, That being said, I told
myself. Eddie just got out of jail from a 3-year bid, and when we find out how he got in, because that's the thing, we in the beginning it just says, oh, he committed a crime, and now he's in lockup. But out, when you find out, and you find out how he got in, and you find out it was because of this bitch, and she's out there sucking dicks.
Oh, man, it's like, yeah. I'm really supposed to feel bad for you and stuff. And
actually, the real kicker, I know what you're probably going to say, but I'll tell you what the kicker was. I hope it was somebody that was halfway important. Dane Cook, really?
I know. See, and you know what? See, great minds think alike. I was like, so you didn't really, you know, cheat up. You kind of cheated. Damn.
He didn't cheat up. He didn't cheat up in this.
Like, exactly. You go shadow to Dane Cook. Like,
you went to shadow. We don't hate Dane Cook.
We don't hate Dane
really?
Cook. Let's just be real about this. We don't hate Dane Cook, but it's Dane Cook.
Well, I don't hate Dane Cook either, but it's like this. He's like this. Really? Really? He's like, really? Really? Was it 2006 again?
Oh, nah. Like, I was blown when I found that out.
But to give Dane Cook his credit for the show, I thought he did. Yeah, he's all right.
Yeah.
Dane's all right when it comes to this stuff. It's just amazing to hear him not make a joke about this
situation. Which was good. He didn't try to be funny.
Yeah, he tried to be funny. He didn't say nothing funny. I did, and to give him some credit for his acting, he did look like a guy that really didn't want to cheat with this chick. But look, I got to be real. I'm trying to get off.
Let's do this.
Hey, now, but can we talk about how when Shadow's cleaning up the house? And he's going through stuff, and then he opens the phone. You don't ever go through the phone. You don't ever. Like, just turn it off, throw it in the box.
You're asking for a break. Yeah.
I was hurt for him.
$1 million question. I know there's three dudes on here, but this $1 million question. Is that really Dane's dick? Look, we all think at the same day on that one day. Like, even if it was, I don't want to know. but here's a good question. I'm pretty sure you asked that to Dane. They'd be like, actually, no, it was this guy's.
It's a stuntman. It was a stuntman dick. It's like, oh, it
could have been plastic.
They signed in a Marky Mark on Boogie Night.
Yes. Yeah, when he pulled out, I was like,
I jumped in the park. It was like, no, you're not, Mark. No, you're not, Mark. Stop. Stop. You wish.
Maybe those kids at MT at the MVP Awards bought it, but we didn't, okay?
Thank you.
But yeah, so let me ask you guys this question then. Mm-hmm. Who is your favorite god, like, the whole show? Who is, like, your favorite god?
Favorite? That's actually really hard, because the funny thing when it comes to me and gods, I've been taught all my life, you know, don't worship multiple gods, and I get the whole little aspect of it. But I always find it fascinating how different each one is, and what do they do to affect humans or whatever. So I can't say I have a favorite, but see, that's unfair. That's unfair. Wednesday. Really? That's unfair. That's unfair. Wednesday. It's Wednesday. I was
gonna say, what's your favorite god? You know, that's not Wednesday, but I guess I should.
That's hard. See, even then, that's hard because I don't like what's the name. I don't like Turnabog. I don't like him. I don't like Vulcan. I was glad when he died. Actually,
yo,
listen, hold up. Let's talk about Vulcan real quick.
Yes, please. Thank you.
So Vulcan, right? Vulcan is essentially.
If we want to be really
Vulcan is racist.
Yeah, if we want to be really smart about it also, Vulcan is technically the god Hephaestus. We can go over that because Hephaestus did the same thing. He was he made man, and on top of that, he made weapons.
Yeah, he forged weapons and stuff, basically.
Yeah, Hephaestus. That's Hephaestus. And y'all guys played God of War 3. I don't know about y'all. I got satisfaction killing that dude.
Listen,
wife, huh? That's how it's going to be, huh?
Yeah, that's how it is. I'm just gonna kill you. Sorry, this is how it goes.
Man, Aphrodite, look at Kratos. Like, yo, man, Aphrodite, a hoe, dog. You need to come to terms with that. She's gonna F everything.
So Vulcan was kind of representative of how, let's be real about this, a lot of racists in this society now is about their guns, and that's how he controlled the small town, was their whole right to bear arms thing.
Everyone.
He's the god of America.
He's the Make America Great Again God.
Deadass.
America Great Again God.
But his history is fire. So I love they translated it, you know, like, to make it more modern. And, like, again, Mr. Wednesday and Mr. World. I'm sorry, Mr. World and, you know, like, the new gods, like, try to make him modern and give him arms. Like, and then I'm in this small town in America where they're like, you know, they even changed the name of the town to Vulcan, Virginia. Like, get the fuck out of here. Like, seriously.
I was like, I hope it ain't nowhere. Like, I hope it ain't nowhere close to Maryland, D.C. I knew it was going to be Virginia. I knew it. Was it going to be Virginia or like Kansas or something? It was going to be one city.
Well, you know, was that the only one that was thrown off at the beginning when you see the, you know, the manager of the factory walking in, like, happy, everybody, like, even the song they're singing, come on, get happy, and then he's walking through and he's falling with a smile on his face, and then the whole festival, you know, like, to celebrate his life or his sacrifice, and I'm like, yeah, this guy is going to be the worst.
Yeah, thank you. That was like, really? So they're sacrificing themselves to make bullets, and I'm like, this is the god I actually hate the most.
Yes.
I don't even have to even know who it is. And the dude that played him, I do not know him by
Corbin Benson?
Corbin Benson. I like him. He's one of the better character actors that I really. So I was like, and it had to be him. Fuck.
Hey, you know what though?
You couldn't get a better TV villain than that guy.
You could have got somebody better, but it would have been way too much. Because come on, he was only going to live for one episode, maybe. Right. I don't know how the show's going yet, but what episode?
I mean, and the fact that like his whole thing was like, I'm gonna marry you because I kind of sort of want to work with the new gods, and Wednesday's like, well, now you gotta die. Sorry.
I like how you did it too, because it was like, so you wanted to help me out. Yes, you did. But gotta be real with you. Mr. World ain't gonna like this shit. So you just made this just so you can snitch on me. Kinda. Mm-hmm. Cool. Yeah, hey, what's up with that? What slice?
And then his head also, smooth comes off.
Mm-hmm.
And it curses him.
Curses believers, actually.
Yes.
Yeah.
Come on. But did you see Shadow's face when everything was going down?
The same face, like, he makes every
Shadow
episode.
Had this, like, exact this stuck face from episode 1 all the way to 8. But in episode 8, it wasn't even a stuck face anymore when he saw Odin's power. Like, when he actually saw his power, he was like, I believe. And I think that's what they wanted Shadow to do. Like, give him this stuck face where he's stuck between believing and not believing, and then finally see Shadow, like, you know, you see Odin or Wednesday unleash, like, yo, that was tough. I love the visuals when he did that.
Now, you know, we've been kind of avoiding this, but were y'all mad too when Anubis was about to banish this bitch to the next dimension and she just disappeared and went back on the earth? Were y'all
I was waiting for her to go, dog. I was so ready for her to go. Like, who the fuck are you talking to Anubis like this? Are you crazy? Like,
yeah, and I love the line he said, you are nothing. You are somebody that I won't remember tomorrow.
Yo.
Like, for you.
Hey, you know what, real talk though? I like Anubis's way of factoring whether the person is good or bad, like weighing against feather. I thought that was actually a pretty interesting twist. Because, like I said, I was kind of trying to figure out, like, so he's weighing the, okay, I get it now. It's just, you know, whether they're good.
And that's actually kind of lore accurate, because the Egyptians believe, the Egyptians believe that. Like, that's a thing where they believe that when you get into that, that's how your goodness is measured. You know, if your heart is heavy, that means you're a bad person. But if you have nothing to worry about, I mean, that's also like kind of a way where in real life people talk about it. If you're a carefree person, have nothing to worry about, your heart is usually lighter. You know, you don't really care too much about what's going on. But then if you're like a, you know, worrisome person, if you're doing bad things and you're always worried that bad things are going to happen to you, it weighs you down. It weighs your heart down. So that's pretty much that representation. I think that's how it's in the book, really.
I do like how he just rips people's hearts right out of their chest like it's nothing.
Like, not even expecting that shit. Like, boom. But then this dumb bitch had the nerve to be like, what are you doing? Like,
what are you doing? Like, shit.
I need that.
chick. I'm trying to see you getting it. I like how, and so here's the thing that gets me. I think the reason why it gets me is because, now, let me make this very clear for myself. If you're atheist, I don't care.
Yeah.
I don't care. I don't even judge you for it. Actually, in a part of me, I actually kind of understand why you're like that. This what don't work, though. One of them atheists in a show like this.
Hey, you know what, though? The thing about Laura... Oh, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
The thing about Laura, it just what her thing was, I like that Anubis kind of had her on the hook. Was like, look, you do your job, I'm taking your soul. You know that, right? You know that, right?
He does.
Yeah, he told her at the end. He's like, I'm not done with you. I mean, you're here for now, but at the end of the day, I'm going to come collect.
Yo, she really, because she thought she was scot-free, like, oh, man, I got him alive. This going to be a breeze. And it's like, nah.
I know, right? I know, right? It's like, Anubis like, all right, check this out, shit. Check this out, shit. Now, I know what you think you're going, but there's a couple things. Number one, you stank. Number two, which I like the fact that every day there are more and more flies around her stanking ass.
Yes.
which is almost representative of how she is as a person to me. Like, because despite, and I will give her this, there is like a bit of redemption there is supposed to be with her, and I understand where it's going, and I actually hope it does do good. You know, it makes you feel, make everybody feel satisfied with whatever little redemption it is she got to get over. But what also gets me is that she's not learning nothing.
No, she really isn't. All she wants, like, she's very selfish, in my opinion, where she just wants to live. Like, what only was, oh, I can see Shadow, like, that's my reason for coming back, and my reason. Like, no, it's because you kissed him, and you felt alive for a second, so you want to get that back. You just want to come back to life. I don't think she loves the dude.
And you also have Matt Sweeney's coin inside you, which is giving you the bestest of luck.
So, yeah. Question. When she fell out of the car, like, and split open, and you know, the coin rolled out, if you were Matt Sweeney, what were you doing?
I would have took the coin and dipped. Fuck it. Because, I mean, at that point, when you find out the revelation that Sweeney and Wednesday were kind of the reason why Laura died, and it played into Shadow doing his shit, you're sitting there like, well, what is your play, Sweeney, in putting the coin back in her? Are you trying to fuck up Mr. Wednesday shit? I mean,
that's what that's the thing about Sweeney. Sweeney right now, as much as he works for Wednesday, a part of me is like, at the same time, he's doing something for Mr. World. And I have no idea what it could be.
I don't know the end game thing. It's like, what's your end game? Because you know, if you do this. Because bear in mind, too, he doesn't have that coin. He's fucked, too.
Yes.
Yeah. Which I don't get. Wait a minute. So if he doesn't have his own lucky coin, he's screwed? I don't understand how that not works.
Oh, the bad luck just happens to him because you saw him get in an accident.
You remember as soon as he lost the coin, everything happened. All the bad luck happened. And
like, good question. Here's actually a good question. Who still believes in leprechauns for that nigga to be walking around, actually?
That is a good question.
But, you know, because he had that episode, right, where they showed, you know, how he came to America.
Yeah, which makes sense in a way.
Yeah.
It's the coin. At this point, he has his lucky coin, so he doesn't really need anyone to believe anymore as much.
Yeah, so he's just a superstition.
And that's why he's downtrodden.
Yeah, because even Shadow was like, well, I thought leprechauns were short. He's like, oh, that's just something that people just say. You know, we're not really, you know, short.
Yeah. So I think at this point, like, he's just an angry, like, nobody believes in me. Fuck, I got my coin anyways. I'm good.
Yeah.
Even though, now, which is amazing, so Jenna's still walking around? Oh, yeah, everybody. Here's me. Even people who don't believe in God believe in demons. So, yeah. So, yeah, there will be Jen walking around. Right. That will make sense.
The fact that we got Ifrit, that was another thing that blew my mind. I was like, oh, shit, we got fucking Ifrit? Yes.
Yes. Yes. It's a good... I was about to say something. No, go ahead. I'm sorry. I'll remember it and I'll come back.
I think even, but like, yeah, even with her trying to believe, like, yeah, I would have left her on the side of the road, man. The second that coin fell out of her chest, it's like, why do I need to keep you alive? Mm-hmm. Obviously, there's something bigger at play, and obviously, that's something that's going into the second season. And we was talking about because we talked briefly about Easter and all that. I think it's funny with her how you see. Well, how that the new gods are at least trying to keep the old gods in control. And
Tech Boy gave Bilquist that thing for Tinder. Like, and I took it as though Bill Quist is kind of sort of working with the new guys, but not really. And I don't know.
Easter clearly media helped Easter, because everybody associates Easter with eggs and all the rest of this stuff and all the rest of this pretty stuff. And yeah, bring Jesus along so Jesus stays alive and stays under control of media. Know what I said? Under the control of media. And that right there expire into 15 different conversations. Just being honest. Because that right there, the fact that she can keep Easter alive off of a lie, off of something that because Wednesday is like, what the hell does this got to do with your solstice? Everything, honey. No, it doesn't.
She knows it. She knows it doesn't. Like, she's.
No, I love the way Wednesday said, like, even you know this is bullshit. Like, she's like, not around the Jesuses.
Right? No, but let's talk about. Can we really talk about how Ian McShane played the shit out of Wednesday?
Oh. Yeah. Yeah. Great.
No. Yeah. Like, and just how him and. And you know, Rick Whittle also played the shit out of Shadow, a very confused Shadow. Like, they balance each other so well.
Dog, when he told Shadow, "We're robbing a bank." When Ian McShane tells you, "We're robbing a bank," it's like, are you gonna really sit there and doubt him? It's the he just smooth robbed the bank, and it was just nothing.
I like how they did it too. Like, really, that old trick. But like, that's not even a trick. Like, oh, it don't work. Give me all your money in here and I deposit it and yada, yada, yada. I'm like, how did that work and nobody from inside the bank came outside?
Like, again, yo. Wednesday could do that shit. It's like, oh, okay, cool.
He's like, yeah, we got to make sure. And even make sure that they had a number where the cops could call them on a payphone. I'm like, yo, really?
Amazing.
But the one thing that gets me, we haven't talked about the person yet at all. Mr. World, played by Crispin Glover.
Yo. Here's
the funny thing. Scary. World is scary. Because World represents several everything. Things. Yeah, almost everything. That's the thing. It's everything in the Marvel world. It's kind of funny. Now, I read somewhere that he's Loki. Is he Loki? What is he?
Yes.
He is Loki.
So I didn't want to spoil anything for anyone, but...
Yeah, I don't want to be major.
Okay.
You are best at making anything.
So, like, because I've read, you know, so I don't want to, like, talk too much into it, because even Dead Wife, her... But remember earlier when I said things get, you know, translated a little different? Dead Wife's story in the show is a little different from what it is in the book, and that's kind of interesting to me. But, yeah, Loki is Mr. World. But what different about this, you know, this version of Loki? You know how Loki's Odin's son?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't think that this is what they're going for.
I don't think so either.
That's gonna be
because if that's what they were going for, then he would call him father when he first met him. But like, and or
the only reason why I said because I know he's super different in the book. In the book, Mr. World is actually a bunch of G-men, if I'm not mistaken, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He's not even really like one single person or something like that. But even the one reason I say that is because I thought so is because the one time they was all together and technology said something, he slapped the shit out of him. And he was like, "This is your elder. You respect him. Do you understand?" And the way he went to is like, that's something a father would do to his son for disrespecting his grandfather. That's what I do to my sons. I smack them upside the head. Don't you do that to your granddad. You respect him. Yada, yada, yada. It felt that way.
Oh, now, because they were admonishing. Because that was the funny thing about how they were. That was the funny thing how they were handling Tech Boy when they were getting on him about trying to, you know, kill Shadow in episode one. They were scolding the fuck out of him. Like, dude, what the fuck are you doing? You fucking up our shit. What are you doing?
Hey, time out. But did anybody in episode 8 when he went to go talk to Bill Quist in the museum? And you saw his fronts, his gold fronts. Yeah. Was it gold fronts or silver fronts?
They were like goldish. They were like platinum, maybe. Who knows? Yeah, it was like this. One of two things, because I read in the book where he was more of a closeted basement dwelling nerd.
Mm-hmm. That's what he. And you know, if you actually read the comic, when you know, for everyone's illustration is actually very different of their representation on the show, because he's actually sexier in the comic, but in the comic, you know the guys that, you know the meme of, not even the meme, you've watched The Simpsons, right? You know that guy who works at a comic book store?
Kamba guy,
exactly. That's literally what he looks like, except, you know, he doesn't have that bun. He looks like that guy, but he smokes his little vape. That's how they illustrated him in the comic books. So, but for the show, they use it like a modern on, you know, the because I think everything is kind of changing, or the just what everyone thought the nerds or comic book guys would look like is changing, you know. And so that's why I think they would, the representation of him, you know, the young douchey, you know, like talk too much, smoke,
the young douchey. The young douchey millennial that loves his dubstep and his vape pen. That dude.
Yes, they went with the millennial, and because he's a little older in the book, so he's also a little older in the actual book itself. But he's a closeted basement dwelling guy, which he kind of looks like, or he kind of gives off that vibe, because he doesn't really have anyone ever around him except for his putties.
That's the thing I actually said to Chris in a different, we was talking about something totally different. I think we was at a con. I was like, I told him, like, nerds are nerds.
Yeah.
Nerds are always going to be the same. Yes, let's be honest with you, compared to now than it was in the mid-90s, we could breathe a lot easier, but nerds are always going to be nerds. They're always going to be loners. They're always going to be different from everybody else. They're not going to go with the flow of everything. They want to do stuff. Either they want to do stuff with themselves or only with their own people. It's like, nerds are always going to be the same. Mm-hmm. We're always going to be the same. And it's just that it's easier now. And like, thank the internet. That's all you pretty much say.
Seriously.
So, see, I like the whole idea with technology, period, being not even just down to the way he looks, but what he can do, what it is. And the one thing I said to my wife that's kind of interesting about him is that technology, of all the new guys, he seems the most scariest. But here's the thing about technology. You can live real easy. It's just that, yeah, it's like,
and he'll lose power if there is no technology.
He'll lose power really quick if there is no technology, if there's no electricity. I mean, yeah, he probably lived because somebody used a can opener, but I doubt that's technology. So you know, it's like, I get what makes him so scary, and at the same time, what makes him so immature.
In this day and age, can we really live without technology?
And see, that's the question.
I mean, we're doing this podcast from, I would guess, three different locations.
Yeah, yeah. Three different locations. And see, that's the thing. If you take away, but here's the thing, technology is the easiest to take away. It really is. When you really think about it, just let your battery run out of juice. Let your phone run out of battery.
Are you serious? Don't you walk around and people be like, oh, you got to charge them? You got to charge Akbar? Like, that's how people are when it comes to, like, their phones.
And I hate it. And I hate it how you can easily run that into an addiction. Like people that don't like cell phones will say it like that. Oh, they always walking around, want to have their charger, want to look at their phone. Oh, I'm like, yo, we did the same thing with television.
Yeah.
So that's media. And I got to be honest with you. If anybody I'm scared of, media.
Because she controls everything.
She can influence a lot of things. I mean, think about it like this. You look at the last episode, right? So, you know, Easter, she takes back to spring. We're in a drought now. You know, Obi got his powers. So now it's like, okay, so what's the next play for media and Mr. World now?
I have no idea. And because we got a person that read the book. So whatever we say is going to sound stupid.
No, I actually want to hear the theories, because I'll give a theory. I'm not going to talk about what happened in the books. I'm going to give a theory. So let me hear, like, because again, it's you know, when you're translating book to media, things change, or a different form of media, things change. So things might change.
I think, you know, God of War. Game of Thrones is an example of changed up a bunch of stuff.
Especially season 7 there was no book for it. I mean, season 6, there was no book for it. None. So they just made that up.
They made all that up in season 6. And so, you know, I get that you have things like that. But I think, if anything, the problem is this. The problem is that fucking zombie walking around.
Oh, I fucking hate her, dog. Like, Jesus Christ.
Saying. I think she might get killed second season.
No, not anything.
But that's the trick, too, because like I said earlier, in the book, her story's a lot different. Deadwife is a lot different from I'm guessing they really pushing her in the show, but Deadwife is a lot different in the book.
I mean, because that's the one thing that's going to fuck up Shadow, is going to fuck up Wednesday shit, is like, Shadow now believes in God, but then Laurel comes in there and like, hey, honey, and it's like,
okay. Here's a good question, but here's a good thing with that, because, okay, we've seen the example of God's fucking with people. Who says he's done fucking with her?
Hmm.
True.
Exactly. And who says that Mr. World doesn't know what the heck is going on and that he ain't got nothing planned? And also, you killed off the God, you killed off technically one God so far, and there's still going to war that's going to they're going to build up to, which I guarantee you, if this show lasts the way they want to, that ain't going to happen till season 3. Yeah. So, and even then, I don't even know how that would look in a show like this. I don't know how that would actually look.
And so, even what's crazy about this show? Mm-hmm. It was in the second episode when they signed on for season 2.
Second episode, for real?
Hey, yes. Stars. When they signed on for a second season, it was just, we were getting to watch the second episode, and wow, the announcement came.
Stars, if they see a good thing going, they do not fuck them. That actually, the funny thing is, that happened with Power, because Power, the first season came out, and I think it got midway through the first season, and Stars was like, fuck it, let's start just busting out second season and keep on going.
Right, they did become a Power. I think what they learned that from was Spartacus.
Definitely Spartacus, because
it was like, and that's what it was like. We got to make sure we have. We're not going to beat out on HBO or Showtime. You know what I mean?
We're not going to have our own audience.
We got to have something that's rocking. And I think because Power got so big and became what it is. You know, come on, that's the number two on primetime cable, which is amazing. That Power is the number two behind Game of Thrones, a black show. Holy crap. You know what I mean? But still, I think Stars had to realize that we actually got, you know, star power here. People watch Black Sails, people watch Spartacus. And I mean, you saw the way people got on Spartacus. Spartacus got so many people watching it. They got so many people to watch that show. So yeah, there's something.
And the thing about Spartacus was, even because, you know, so the first season happened, and then Andy Whitfield, RIP, you know, he happened. Mm-hmm. And then they were between that. And you know what they did? They didn't drop Gannicus thing in the middle. Mm-hmm. You know, while they were like, I think, didn't Gannicus come before the actual second season?
Something like that. I believe so.
Yeah, because before they went into recasting, you know, Spartacus and everything. And then it was so seamless. Yeah, you could tell it was a different Spartacus, but it was super seamless because it just went right back into the story, and they kind of, you know, it meandered a little bit, but nobody cared because it was such a vicious show.
Like, I think, you know, it's kind of funny. Even the shows is not that, you know, even with their shows that not don't get that much ratings, they get ratings like, what is that, Outlander. I watched it with my freaking wife.
I've never seen it, but I heard that it's pretty good. Like, they're in the fourth, fifth, or fifth season right now. I'm like,
they're going into fourth season? No, third season. I'm sorry.
How?
Wow. Okay. Anyway, I thought it was four. Anyway,
I thought it was four too. Because the other thing was in. I mean, they have canceled some shows. I think the White got canceled, but they brought it back as the White Princess or something like that.
Yeah, something like that. I believe.
Stars is making some noise because American Gods, I think, is supposed to be your answer to a Game of Thrones, but neo modern type.
Yeah.
You needed a heavyweight show that was written well, that was probably a known property before it got to television, which it was. And they got a good one. Good casting. Whoever's directing these episodes. Let me make that very clear. And I said it in the beginning of the podcast. The visuals of this show is incredible. Incredible. Everything they try to show you is it does kind of come off comic booky a little bit, but
very much so. Yeah,
it's like you're actually. There's a difference between seeing Sin City come to life, and then there's a difference between seeing like another comic book come to life. You can tell like this was made and it's coming to life, and the way it's shown. You know, remember in when they showed Bill Quist's whole story. When she was like in the temple and all that to the people that was having sex, and remember everybody got sucked up into her. I'm sorry.
Yo, that was sick. She sucked up homeboy with the crown head.
The dude with the crown head.
And then went and said, fuck it, I'm just going to suck everybody up.
Dog, fuck it. Here's what wild me out though, right?
And look, here my look. Real quick, and when that all happened, here's my wife. That party was lit. I'm like, yeah, son.
Dude, lit is an understatement, because it's like everybody getting there. It was like the shit from the Matrix Reloaded and shit with the orgy scene.
It was the orgy scene.
That's what I thought about as soon as I saw it. I was like, the Matrix.
Yeah, man, no.
The show's visuals. Everyone likes the show's visuals for what they are. I like them because I'm looking at what I read. Like, literally, like lifting words from page to look at. And every time Shadow went in that God sequence, that dream sequence thing, that's what would happen in the book. And they would narrate it so well. And it just happens like he's walking on skulls and you're reading it and then you're seeing it. And I'm like, wow, this is amazing. Like, just looking at it like, this is fucking amazing.
Now, give me a name here, because I'm not really sure. Who's the one that's basically storytelling all these different stories of the God?
What's his name? Not Jackie L.
And what does he do?
The guy with Anubis. You know the guy with Anubis?
Yeah, I know the guy with Anubis,
That runs the... that's him.
Oh, okay.
The dude who's doing the Coming to America stories?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Interesting.
I want to know, I don't know if I'm getting more guest passes for the pool.
Trying to think, what was it? Oh, you were mentioning the whole thing with, you know, innocent folks being caught in the crossfire, and we mentioned the thing with Bilquis. I felt bad for homeboy in the plane that thought he was going to be part of the Mile High Club.
Yo.
You are going to live.
Him, and then the ending scene with him on the bus, I was like, oh, well, sorry for
here you. Here we go again. No, but can we talk about what is she doing in Mississippi? Like, this is her plan. That's my thing. That's the next thing. It's like, okay, so whatever happened at Easter's party happened, but what's going to happen moving forward? So now, like you said, she's definitely in the mix, but is she going to turn on the new gods because she's an old god and she holds allegiance to an old god, or is she going to Vulcan, you know, pull a Vulcan? I would hate to see her pull a Vulcan because I'd hate to see her die because I'm in love with her. But
yeah,
no. That's why I say, oh, get sucks out of her vagina.
to be honest, even though I've seen it happen so many times. But if I ever meet her in person and she's like, "Yo, what's good? You want to go? You know, let's go to the bathroom." Or where's the bathroom in the back? If I'm ever flying on a plane and she's there, and she's like, "Oh, where's the bathroom?" I'm like, "Yeah, let's go. Let's do it."
Here's her. That was a show. Yeah, it was a show. Whatever. Are you gonna put me inside of your vagina or not? How we gonna do this?
I mean, you can be in my vagina, but you're not gonna get sucked. I'm just saying.
I love you. I love you.
No, that's how homie sounded in the beginning. But that was such a, you know, for a sex scene, that was also such a very powerful episode, because as soon as she was done, you saw like her transformation. She went back to this, like, you know, she was looking really old at first and, like, kind of dirty and ashy. And then as soon as she was done having sex, she was just, like, queen. And you could just see her you saw her transformation. And I'm like, damn.
Listen, the lesbian, I
would do that.
I was curious how these lesbian chicks were getting sucked in. I was like, oh, okay. Now I know. Wow. Okay. I was curious.
There was scissoring.
How bad is that? How bad is that? If you're a lesbian, that's it. Like, wait a minute, why are my legs going upward like this? Wait a minute, what? No!
No, but you have to admit, though, she did have a girlfriend. Remember? Her girlfriend died from AIDS. She didn't suck her up. So you have to imagine, how are they doing it?
Yeah. You know, easy. I can cut it on and off. I need somebody to be here with me. Look, she's a god. I'm pretty sure she figured that out already.
Because I think that's what it is. Her powers, when it came to... So, I was, you know, at first I used to think, okay, is this just going to be men? But no, she was equal opportunity. And you know another thing about this show was the showrunners, Brian Fuller and Michael Green, they were like, look, there's going to be a lot of equal opportunity in this show. You see breast and tits and vagina, but you also see
penis.
And they did it, you know... They show dicks. I was like, okay.
Stars, man. They can get away with that shit, man. HBO is kind of like, 50-50. We'll show tits.
I know, right?
We're not gonna show dick.
Yeah, HBO doesn't show dick. That's crazy.
Are you sure about that?
Well, I'm thinking.
I'm thinking about Game of Thrones. No dick.
Game of Thrones. I mean, yeah, once or twice.
Oz, they kind of sidestepped.
Oz kind of show, but no, this show said full on penis. Yeah. Like, penis. We saw penis in like episode 2 when Shadow's cleaning the house. Penis. Then we saw penis again in that episode when, you know, they were trying to show us, you know, when they were showing like where these people were going to.
Yeah.
She was sucking up. You remember they showed like.
And of course, we're seeing it with the gin, which was. Real weird, which is weird, weird because I like how people, that was another one that a lot of people either didn't pick up on or don't know on. Jin is short for what we know as genie.
Yes.
And the whole genie mythos is nothing.
It's not like what Aladdin made it look like.
Yeah, blame Disney, blame even, you know, even to an extent, the Islamic religion getting changed up a little bit. A lot of that changed.
If you've read the, is it 40 Days and 40 Nights, or what's the name of that book, or 40 Stories? Yeah, 40 Days and 40 Nights. The genie in that Aladdin story is totally different from what Disney did.
Yeah, totally different. I know that. I knew that even as a kid, that they're magical people that were, but they're prisoners or something. They got to be released in some type of way. Now, I know what you're saying. Ha, 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 released. That's why he had sex. Shut up, sure, for a second. All right? I ain't speaking like I wasn't talking like that. They are kind of dicks too.
I'm also kind of curious on Shadow's deal with Jennelbog. Like, basically, he played checkers with him twice. The first time he lost, so he gets killed by him. But he did the deal the second time and was like, hey, all right, you help Wednesday. Once we're done with
this, I'm still going to kill you.
You can kill me.
Like, I love Jennelbog for that.
So I'm curious, is Shadow going to try to get this, or is that going to be the end of the series? Where it's like,
I think Chernabog is going to die.
I think Chernabog is going to die before any of that happens, man. He probably got in the back of his head, like, yeah, I'm going to still kill you. You know that, right? And of course, and I never remember that guy's name.
Peter Stormare.
Peter Stormare. He's fucking fantastic. God.
He played fantastic. That part very well. He knows how to play it. He was perfect. It's like, if I need somebody to play somebody that, like, is just, old as fuck, done with this shit.
I need Russian or I need Eastern European. Mm-hmm. I need Eastern European, maybe Russian. Who do I get? Hey, Pete, what you doing? I ain't doing nothing.
There you go.
What's funny is you guys have seen John Wick Volume 2 or Chapter 2.
Yeah.
You know he was in the beginning of that.
He was just basically scared shitless until John came into the room.
He was like, man.
Because he's back.
He had his drink like Boba Yaga.
Yeah, Boba Yaga. But can we talk about the djinn? I know. You know, the djinn and what's his name? Salim. They change clothes, right? They swap clothes.
Yeah, they basically swap lives, essentially.
Yes, but do you know it kind of like tripped me out when I saw the djinn in what's his name's suit, and then you didn't realize it till you saw the episode happen and saw Salim come out of the hotel with the sweater.
Came out then. So who's that guy in the suit that came out before that then? Who was the djinn that we saw early in the show then?
That was the same djinn, but since he swiped That tripped me out for a second. And I was like, whoa. Then I was like, wait a minute, nah, it's just the djinn. Never mind.
Now I gotta say it's amazing what I'm going through because I've been married to my wife 7 years and 5 years, I'm sorry. I've been married to her for 5 years, known her for about 10+ years. Came out very on stance saying, ugh, Yowie's ugly as stuff. Like, I don't understand Yowie. Like, I get why girls watch it. Ugh. But for some reason, watching this scene, she was like, ooh, that was hot.
I'm confused.
Slow motion, visuals. Like, what is it?
Real talk, guys. It's like us. It's always something little. It was the eyes.
Her
girlfriend was like that. Her girlfriend was like that because her girlfriend's kind of a hoe like that. So, yeah, I understand why she's like that. I'm watching the whole scene now. It was during the daytime, and my kids are off of school. They're off from school that day.
Jesus Christ.
Everyone watching is like, I hope neither of these kids run into this room hey, Dad! Like, I hope that doesn't happen.
Yo.
Because that's... but at the same time, I'm looking at it like, okay, I get the beauty of this. I really do. I actually do. And then after it was over, if I looked at my wife, I'm not gay. No, you're not gay. Okay, I just had to make sure.
No, because I'm... Okay, so, because on our channel, we do a review of the episode, every episode. And I'm not going to lie to you. I'm watching that episode like, yo, this is actually pretty beautiful. Like,
it was. I like the visual of it. I love the whole
thing. This is amazing. And what's funny is I've been talking about Bill Keys having sex for like majority of the, you know, like two episodes prior. And now they give us this. And I'm still talking about it the way I'm talking about Bill Keys having sex. Like, it, they did it in a very tasteful way.
You know,
and they didn't compromise because it's guy on guy. They kept, you know, very tasteful, very like grown up sex scene.
Exactly.
You know, it wasn't rough. It wasn't like like two guys making grunt noises. Yeah. And like, you know, like Spartacus man on man is like disgusting.
Dude, Spartacus man on man was basically what do bros think gay sex is, like lots of grunting and just it's like, okay, geez,
yo for me this is a tripped out scene because it was a year prior, maybe a year prior, I was on catching up on Penny Dreadful because I actually loved that show and I didn't get watched like the last two seasons of that, and they had a straight up guy, they had a gay sex scene on there. At the same time there was another sex scene, right, and the other sex scene was, oh god, I can't remember her name, and Timothy Dalton were having sex, and Dennis opposite to two gay guys having sex. I'm like, wow, there's a lot to kick in right now.
Yeah, and I think some people would do it that way, so you know, it's not all gay sex, and you know, they're not just looking at all gay sex, but American God said this episode, period. There was almost no sex scenes that episode. It was just them. And you had to watch it. If you didn't want to watch it, turn it off and go somewhere else. But you're going to watch this.
Now, that being said, let's talk about the real star of that whole thing. Remember before where he was in that office?
Yo, sitting down for like 8 hours?
Let's talk about the real star of that scene. That orange juice that secretary had, that looked bomb. With the black top, I'm like, yo, that's the good orange juice.
Oh, I put in, got God, no man.
That junk. It's like 100% squeezed. Oh,
no, but you know what's funny? You know what I also appreciate about this show is it tackled a lot of social issues, like a lot. Very under, you know, it underscores it, in its, you know, in the rest of the show, it's like, you know what you said when you said. I'm sorry, let me get back, let me go to this point real quick. When you said your religion says, and the Bible says, don't worship, you know, not, I think that's one of the Ten Commandments, where it says, don't worship any other gods besides me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know what I saw is that every god had their own worshipers. No one person worshipped two gods.
Yeah. It's interesting. Not one person had multiple gods they worshiped in that. Yeah, that is something I noticed.
It goes back to that point, that, you know, or, you know, from the Bible where it says, don't worship any of the gods except me. So it's like, because, you know, the Africans could have called, you know, any of their other African gods, but they call, you know, maybe that tribe, this is who they worship, and they worship him, and so they called him, you know, and the Norse gods didn't call any of them, called Odin. Mm-hmm. Oh, it was very, you know, and we all know Norse mythology, there's not just one, there are multiple gods, but
there's multiple there too. And yeah, even with, so, that's something I picked up playing on God of War. And like, it was like, remember in God of War 2 where Kratos became the God of War?
Yes.
Specifically, the soldiers were like, look what we have done, Kratos, in your honor. They didn't call Zeus. They didn't call Athena. No, we're calling the God of War, the one that's running us, the God of War. Yeah. So that, yeah, I get that. I didn't notice that. No other, everybody had their own set worshippers.
Well, I mean, it was the East Asians. That's kind of like the animated sequence. I think was it episode 5, 6. I think that they had it, and they were talking about like the Asians that went through the Bering Strait to come to America and stuff, and how
they
pushed the whole idea that sometimes gods actually do come with the actual
people that are going to a different country and stuff. And but, like when they got there, but
you saw when that lady died, yeah. the God died. Yeah, the only person that truly believed her was God. Believed in her died. What happens to a God when they have nothing to know? When nobody believes in that God no more.
Yeah. And you have to. And you have to really. And it factors into the fact that if she actually survived enough to tell other people about her, oh, that God would have survived. But now,
but that was heavy because it was also in terms of when people saw that. Oh, she worshipped this God up to that. You know, to the extent where she actually gave her life for the God, and people were like, "Nah, this isn't." You know, that's the thing we're talking about with, you know, the casualties or what gods do to human beings. And it's like, you can actually give your life to a God and it won't necessarily change.
Oh, yeah.
And their situation didn't change until, like, you know, because the guy came and he was like, nah, we don't, you know, the illustration, it was very, you know, good because her children were like, we just lost our mom because of you. So they left him. Well, like, you know, we got food now. We got water and everything. We don't necessarily need him because he never really... This is how people look at it. He never really did anything for us.
Exactly.
You know? Exactly. That's instead, how... He took our you know, our leader away. He, you know... And, you know, you don't look at the fact that if maybe that hadn't happened, though, you know, those people wouldn't come with the food and all that other good thing. You know,
let me kind of help you on that. It's sort of like how people, like, mom, why are you going to church so much? Why are you going to church so much? Why are you going to church so much? And people kind of have this thing like, well, God's not helping us, or God's not helping you, whatever. And in actuality, the God got them to where they needed to be so they could survive.
Right. The
problem is, because mom died, Who's going to keep up that tradition and disappear? And we've seen it again with Matt Sweeney's bit of his background, where we saw basically Emily Browning. She played somebody else. She played like a girl that came from the old country and
bread and Ireland. Milk.
And when she got to America, when she had her own children and grandchildren, she told them kids about those stories. It's like, your grandma, you sound stupid.
And I think even her husband was like, nah, you need to, you know, cut it out with the kids. You know, the kids don't need this.
Like, that's some old world stuff. You know what I mean? And that happens. That just happens. It's hard to keep that section of the religion up. We're seeing it right now. Let's just be real. We're seeing it right now with black people right now. And with a lot of us abandoning Christianity, a lot of us like, no, this was used to control us and used to keep us down. We're seeing that right now. And the interesting thing we're seeing about that is people that believe that at the same time, say, no, I believe religion, but I believe in the spirit of God. I believe in what that ain't. You know what I mean? Like that's not God. Like, people are waking up to different things all the time. You know what I mean? So when you see that example of the grandma dying and the kids going off on their own, maybe God didn't. You know what I mean? But the guy didn't, you know, go with them. Like, that was the important part about it. The guy didn't go with them, and that's how.
And what that ends up showing us now is what ways to avoid. This is Wednesday's plan. He's like, look, at the end of the day, when he was talking to Easter, he's like, yo, take the color. Take the spring back from them. Show them your power so that they will have no choice but to come back to you. And Easter will finally be yours again. I have to share with the Jesuses. Like, so much. and, you know, what I think was great about that episode is I didn't think media and technical didn't think she was going to do it, but she did it. I didn't even think she was going to do it.
It's one thing to say, and that's what I'm saying. I think you're going to see a lot of people. I think that's going to happen in the second season, where there's a lot of the gods are either going to challenge Mr. World or they're going to challenge Odin. Where it's like, no, I like my stance in the new world. Or, no, I'm not going to let you do what you want to do. Or, straight up, I don't give a crap about Mr. World. I don't. You know what I'm
doing? I don't give a crap about neither of you guys, as long as it's not fucking up my shit.
Think about it.
That's how Vulcan was. Vulcan was kind of like that. Vulcan was like, look, dude, people want to shoot each other no matter what. I'm good.
And as long as they're doing it in my name, I'm great. you know, they're using Vulcan bullets, so they're doing it, they're praising me every time they're doing it, fine. Like, keep, what, fuck you, Odin, fuck you, Wednesday, like, are you, you're like about to take this from me?
And I like how World's idea of keeping Odin alive as a god was making,
very practical.
Was very practical. Making a nuke and naming it Odin. I gotta be honest with you, nobody's gonna forget that for a long time.
Yeah.
So yeah, you'll be alive, but you'll be out my face too.
Yeah, and you'll hit China, which is, you know, which most of the world hates, or maybe just America, because you are in America, you're going to become, so Odin, the name Odin is going to be synonymous with, like, American, make America great. Is it me? Or it was Mr. World trying to make America great? Or is Odin trying to make America great again? Or make the gods Odin, great again?
And see, that's the thing that gets me about both of them. I still don't know what Wednesday is up to. Despite him trying to ensure that he's alive. Note what I said that. Him staying.
He's selfish.
Because gods are selfish. If you haven't none noticed that. Yeah. So far in this whole show, every god is selfish in their own way.
Nancy was was one of the most selfish. Even though he was great in that scene, but he was also very, very selfish. She doesn't care about the life she's ruining.
Nancy don't care, because Nancy is more of a god of he comes off more of a god of destruction and chaos.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's what he is. Yeah, that's what
he's a mischief or something of the sort.
Yeah, he's chaotic. He's a mischief, chaotic god.
Yeah,
that's what they are. They like. Let put it this way: if Ares was in the show, if Ares didn't have a knife in his hand or a gun in his hand, you'd be like, "What is he doing here?" Not knowing what he's.
Ares destroys you by giving you paperwork to sign.
Real god of
war. That's the god of war right there. Business.
Right.
But Mr. World is the embodiment of almost progress and almost the embodiment of American life. It's hard. It's really hard to really pinpoint, because I still don't know, at least as a viewer of this show and not a reader, I still hard to pinpoint what he's really up to.
They just say globalization, so it's just like...
Yes, globalization, he wants to globalize everything, like... He wants to globalize the power of gods. He wants to, and at the end, because what's going to happen is, if he, to me, right, the way the show is going, I'm going to say it like this. If he has his way, everyone is going to turn around and worship him.
Yeah, yeah.
Because he's the one that's essentially franchising out all the gods out for his needs, essentially. That's what it sounds like to me.
And franchising out, does it sound like that's perfect for media to take over? And then sound like it's perfect for technology to take over in their own way. Mm-hmm. Those three control every god.
Everything. With technology taking over technology, I mean, think about it. He gave Bilkis the phone with Tinder. So he's, in a way, every time she uses it and people worship her, it turns around and she's worshiping him.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah. This is what we call trickle. It's basically trickle down. Yes. It's trickle down. That's where.
And then you turn it around because Tinder's on a global scale now. You turn around and you're worshiping Mr. World.
Yeah. And I mean, and you see the conflict with her is that she's like, I guess I'll take the phone, but then tech dude is like, but you know you need me, right? You realize what this comes with, right? There's attached to this.
Right.
So
when I. If we need you, I'm like, what's she gonna do? Swallow everybody up with a vagina? I mean, yeah, you can use that anytime, but how's that gonna work?
I mean, I don't know.
Throw a party?
Yeah, that's true.
Throw a sex party?
Or like everybody, or is she gonna be like one of those people where the world is coming to an end? Everybody, shut up and have a party. Is that gonna have bees? I don't know.
If we had to finish, she could
just.
Oh, go ahead.
I think of the powerful gods. Like, I think when it all comes, like. That is just a fraction of her power. Like, she actually has power, mm-hmm. or power on top of that. Because Easter is the one who gives spring. I never knew she could take it.
Yeah, that blew my mind. I was like, oh shit, she does thing.
I kind of seen that coming, because you know, God, if somebody give it, God can give you, and God can take away from you. If we go by that same type of principle. With all the flowers that bloom and all the bright, notice all the bright colors that was in that scene when you first saw her and all of that, and the way everything looked so beautiful and all that. And the second Wednesday said, take it away from them, and she took it away from her, how everything looked dead. Yes. Just straight up dead. Even God can take away. Yeah.
So, if that's the case, maybe Bilkis can give love, and she can also create hate.
In turn, cause war. I'm thinking the same thing. If she can make sex, she can do the opposite. But at the same time, that's what stopped her from being powerful, was the opposite. So,
I mean, maybe there's a thin, you know how people say there's a thin line between love and hate? So when you're making love, you turn it, so she can get power either way.
Yeah, but love is just a lot easier for her.
It's really easy for Nancy. Like, so what about what Nancy doing? Oh, Nancy there for the ride.
No, I think that's all he's there for.
I mean, he's making suits for people, and then that's about it. He's just chilling, like, well, I'm good, you know, I'm just here, I'm talking. And I like how Shadow was just sitting there, him and Wednesday are sitting there, Wednesday's reading the paper, and Shadow's like, God, will this dude just shut up, please, just make the suits, Kathy, just stop talking.
And then he stops making the suits and gets on this pedestal and delivers this story about a queen. And then, you know, and then what the message was, everybody's in. So the new gods have theirs. We need ours.
Yeah. So,
yeah. Very powerful, powerful show. Like, powerful lines. And it very, I also, like, again, I said I like how they tackle certain social issues. And that is, most shows can tackle.
The one thing that is funny about America, at least I believe the way they frame America in the show and what you can see in real life, is that a lot of people, even people in religion, say that America is a God's place. But in the show, you see that everybody worships something. Yeah. Everybody is following something, whether it is religion, whether it is themselves, whether it's something as you on your phone, you know what I mean?
Well, that's funny that people say that we're a godless country, and I'll be honest with you, I feel the only people that say that are basically Christians that say that, which I think is...
Christians say that more than everybody else, and yet Christianity is like the big daddy in America. It's like 62% of Christian. What are you talking about?
Listen, man, I think me and Dee can say this and stuff. I kind of knew, probably from when I was in middle school, that there was always this civil war in the Kennedy community a bit, where it's like you got the Christians that are hardcore. These are the ones that's all like, gay people are wrong, fuck them, and blah, 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 blah. Then you got some Christians that might be like me and D, where it's like, I don't see the problem with gay people. They ain't harming anybody. Believe in God? All right, cool. Fine,
Only speaking on at least what I follow, is that I think Christianity has changed up. And what I mean changed up is that the world has changed up. We don't have enough people to explain, mm-hmm. at least explain the Bible correctly, or at least explain the way God works correctly. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because what we're noticing is, especially, you know, coming from the 80s and the 90s, a lot of people got screwed over into believing that God can give them whatever. We can talk about it, but I don't feel like talking about it. You and I talk about Copeland and how Copeland screwed people out of money left and right. We can talk about, you know.
Oh, Kenneth Copeland?
Creflo Dollar, who's just straight up about his, straight up about what he does. So, you know what I mean?
I mean, didn't he ask people to give money in his church so he could buy a new plane? Like,
G5.
For G5. Like,
the old one is kind of like the, it's not bad. It's not the worst jet. The ride is not smooth anymore. Are you fucking kidding me, sir?
I'm like, here's me. How many people in Atlanta are homeless right now? You can help out right now. Yeah. It pisses me off because people like them make people like T.D. Jakes, who's legit, look bad.
Oh, yeah, because T.D. Jakes is like, hey, if you want to tithe, cool. Yeah. If you don't, whatever,
One thing I give T.D. Jakes is like, look, nigga, I ain't hiding my fucking Escalade. But here's the thing I got to tell you. I'm not spending my money on just bull crap. I'm giving back to my people. I'm making sure this happened and that happened. Look, I know half of y'all want to cuss me out for giving Tyler Perry a stance, but guess what? That dude has his own studio hiring black folk left and right. I give back. Like, boom. Yo, I didn't boom. Sit here and tell y'all to. I ain't sit here and tell y'all, hey, I need a new fleet of I need a new fleet of cars. I need a new airplane. No, God's gonna provide for me. It's up to me, back to you. But guess what? People don't see that because we got so many false people walking around corrupting religion, and I'm pretty sure that's gonna play a part in the second season somehow.
I want them to dive into that.
I don't, you know what? Yeah,
don't
keep
give away, don't give away nothing. Don't give
yeah,
away
I'm
nothing.
Not talking. I'm not talking anymore. I'm done. I'm done.
Yeah.
So
yeah, man. Like it's gonna get deep in season two. I hope that you know, because what from what I've read, I hope they do what to get into to make it even more impactful. But you know, whichever way they decide to go, if they decide to change some things because America, then I'm okay with that. I mean, I'll watch it because I'm already into the show anyway, so I'll watch it. You know?
What I will say is this. I hate the people that look at this show every week, and of course they're going to do a review every week and all that and make their own blogs. Here's my thing. If Dead Wife is your favorite character and you hate all preachiness of the show, you need to stop watching this show.
No,
you
deadass.
Really need to stop watching
it's
this
not show. The show for you.
It ain't the show for you. But she did nothing wrong. Look, let me guess. You're atheist and you don't understand none of the show, do you? Right? I'm right, am I? All right, stop. Just stop, dude. Obviously, you missed the first lesson of the show.
Like,
so what else? Like,
it's so funny because the show goes in on the gods itself. They go in on the gods. Like, but then who see just see gods and it's like, oh my God, I can't deal with this. Like, I had this one person tell me that it's, you know, it's a, you know, this one person was arguing with me the other day, not even arguing, because I decided just to mute the person. He was like, man, no, again, he was like, oh, I the way I'm looking at American gods is so trash, but I'm not understanding what's going on.
Understand what's going on? Are you giving a chance to understand what's going on?
That's what I'm saying. And the person went on to say, I was like, you know, from him, but he's like, yeah, I'm pretty sure it does the book no justice. So you haven't read the book, you watched the first episode, and you're saying it's trash off the strength of you don't understand what's going on.
This is why we got elitists in comic books. Like, wait. So you like the, you don't know who Black Panther is, but you already have an opinion of what should be in a, you don't know nothing.
And that's what fucks it up for everybody, because like I said, I'm a person, I'll fully admit, never read the comic, never book. But I was just sucked in on the visuals. I'm like, the fuck is this? All right, I guess I'll watch it and stuff. And it's just like, all right, cool.
To me, it's like, show me where we're going. I give you three episodes. Show me where we're going. Show me where we're headed. And I remember I told that to my wife. Like, we give every new show three episodes. By the second, halfway in the second episode, it was like, so we like this show, right? Like, yeah, okay, cool.
It was funny. Three episodes in, you almost didn't know where they were going.
You still didn't know where they were going.
But they were going somewhere, but you know,
we just knew the basic premise of only new guys.
It kept you in with this premise, it kept you in with his characters, it kept you in with his actors, it kept you in with his story. Like, you didn't know where the show itself was going, but you if you didn't like the show because Ian McShane was doing, or like the way him and Shadow were bouncing off each other, even fuck it. As much as I hate Dead Wife, I like her, you know, the trio with her, Salim, and Mad Sweeney, that episode, right? I thought that was pretty good. Like, you know, when she was stealing, they were stealing his cab, and he comes out like, please stop stealing. Like, he said, please. He had a gun to somebody's face, and he said, please stop trying to steal my taxi.
Yeah.
I had to pop one in the air, telling my son, make another move, and you're dead. Like, I'm not telling you, please. When I come out to you stealing my shit. Like, Salim is such a good guy. Like, I think of all the people on the show, Salim is, like, the only good person. Like, truly good person. Because she's not even a good person, to be honest.
He's not. And I think that's the whole point. I think that's what a lot of people, and I'm without me going too deep, too. I think a lot of people don't realize that about religion. Is that religion is supposed, well, not religion. Well, spirituality, learning about God, whatever you want to call it. Supposed to be realizing that, hey, we're all not good. Hell, some of us are pretty freaking bad. But you have to realize what you are, who you are, and you have to rectify it. And what you're seeing with Shadow is him trying to go through that. You're seeing him trying to realize that there is something bigger than him, that he is going to play a bigger role in something that even he doesn't understand right now. It's a beautiful concept. And if you can get around, that's the show, and not sit there and try to analyze everything like you're a freaking critic or something, then you can really truly enjoy it. And I get it if you don't like it because the visuals and just be real, it goes over your head. I'm fine with that. You know what I mean? I'm fine with that.
Like, you don't, and that, I think that's what you mean when you say, oh, I don't understand. I think I'm just going to guess because I don't understand what's going on. Yes, it's going over your head, and that's fine. Just come out and say that. Don't trash the show because of that. I mean, your opinion is very mute anyways. The opinion on the show is very high. I think it was one of the highest rated summer shows this year. Or spring? Mm-hmm. Was it spring show? Spring, summer?
I think it's spring.
Yeah, it was spring and then summer. Yeah, it was one of the... it's opening, it's... premiere episode was one of, it was rated, it was highly watched, so fuck out of here, dude. Like, and the thing is, it kept its core fans moving into season two, and I think that's what Starz does with all their shows. You know, their premiere episodes might be like stupid, like the numbers could be stupid high, but like as the seasons go on,
it held steady. I give it that.
Yes, think about Black Sails. Dog, I love that show. I hated the way it ended, but I love that show.
Yeah.
Like, it had its core fans, and Dumbers kept it, you know, I mean, because it could have been canceled at any point because if it dipped, but because of its core fans, it stayed, and American Gods, to me, is, you know, may not have the same as it did in season one, but it would have its core fans, and I hope it's going to keep going, you know, maybe we get 3 or 4 seasons out of this, but I'm looking forward to more American Gods, yo. I don't know about you guys.
I mean, like definitely. You know, I guess apparently some of them, well, no, can't talk about it. Never mind. Can't talk. Never mind. Remake.
It's all.
I was back up on that. I was like, but yeah, you know, like I said, I'm curious to see if season two brings in even more gods and stuff, but, you know.
I think we're going to get a couple more gods. I think, aren't they going to be in San Diego?
I mean, if they're at San Diego,
I haven't seen nothing. But what I read up, I have seen nothing about San Diego. So,
I feel like they should do San Diego. Like, they have this, you know, they have this big platform now. Just go and do San Diego, because I mean, because Ricky Whittle and I think the guy who's, you know, who does the Coming to America, who narrates the show, like they did a convention in Germany. Like, everyone is busy on that show. Like, because I follow them on Twitter, and they're like always somewhere doing something, talking about American Gods. Like, it's a phenomenon around the world. So, I just feel like San Diego is the biggest, you know, the next best thing.
Now, before we go, only question I got left is just real, because we mentioned at the beginning of the show. Because I know a lot of people like to, you know, especially, you know, us brown people, we like talking about it. But I have a feeling. I just want to know. How did you feel when Nancy was given that speech on the slave ship? How did you feel?
I stood up and clapped.
I
thought it was very, very powerful. And not, like, how he outlined, he gave them their timeline of their lives. And you're watching it and you're seeing it and you're like, damn, this is exactly how it's going to happen. Or this is what happened. Like, this is history right here.
The part that really hurt me, it gave me black man rage and black man pride at the same time.
Yes.
Because the part that got me, because it showed me how it made the legacy made me feel good because my people are strong. But at the same time, it made me want to cry. At the same time, he's like, let me give it for you. 100 years. You're fucked. 200 years. You're still fucked. I'm like, how?
Hey, you know what?
Like, I was pissed. I was ready. And when he like, I see him. That's it. That right there. When he did that, I was like, like, that's how everybody feel right now. That's every white person we see.
Seriously.
You know what it reminded me of? I don't know if you watched The Newsroom.
Yes.
You remember when Jeff Daniels' first episode broke down on why America sucks?
Yes, yo.
That's what that speech of Mr. Nancy. It was equivalent in the fact saying something that
shock value,
shock value, but also truth. Because he broke down like, "What makes America great?" And he's like, we're America great. Get the fuck out of here. Oh, we're not great because of X, Y, and Z. You know,
education says that. I was like, blah, blah,
blah. It's like, holy shit, he ain't lying, man. Like, everything is right. It's like, you're just like, there's
something about clap. The truth. There's something about the truth. You know what I mean? That always will always get you, man. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's all. You know, I just had to ask about that because I know we all felt the same. So this is what I'm gonna do. Calling everybody to come up to Suitland Road at 8 o'clock. You're just gonna walk.
A friend of mine said something though. He said, "What if, you know, in that scene, to be a little more impactful, is he brought out a cell phone, right? You know, like, because he was telling them about the future. What if he brought out a cell phone and he turned it on and he showed like a picture of or a video of like a black man getting shot by the police? Like, how impactful? Because he did say something about shooting you in the streets." Because they don't even care about you. Like, when he was saying that, what if he brought a cell phone out? Like, how impactful would that have added more to the scene? Or was that, or was it?
I don't know. I think it was bad enough that he was already wearing all
three piece.
Yeah, three piece suit. This nigga pulled out a cell phone. I think everybody would say, Demon, and he would have jumped off the shit.
I mean, they're already looking at him. Well, I don't know if they were seeing it from our perspective, but you just see Spider face. So,
yeah, like I said, you know God when they...
And like you said, it's just he busts out a cell phone, and they're already wilding out as is, but they see the cell phone, and they're just like, holy shit, like, okay, so we're burning this? Okay, we're burning this.
Yeah, because I think if he had brought out the cell phone, he wouldn't... the question is, but we're also going to die, and he says, yeah, but at least you're going to die on your feet or something like that. I don't think that would have been asked, because I think you would have just made up your mind at that point to go fuck up Whitey on the top of the show, you know?
Yeah, but because the dude had to ask the question, like, well, die, like, fool, you already did. I just
like, regardless of whether, like, it's like, regardless of whether they take over that ship, you're still on your way to America. They'll fucking put a bullet in your head as soon as
you drop. Yeah, you know, but can we address the fact that, you know, he said the stereotype, y'all niggas gotta learn how to swim.
Yeah.
She's like, where's my mother? Man, she's over the... They threw her over the ship.
You can't swim. Now, that being also said, here's me. If you want to be swim deeper, somebody said, well, turn the ship around and go back home. Go ahead, nigga. They don't want you.
Because I guarantee you, by the time they get there, they're going to think it's the freaking slaves coming back. The slavers coming back.
They're going to try to kill the ship.
Just imagine if you're on the coast of Gabon. Just imagine you're on the coast. Bond, man, we finally got rid of all those broke niggas. Man, these motherfuckers back. For real, look at it. Oh, these niggas. I knew they were going to take over.
I mean.
Second, I have one more question before we go. So, you remember when the Vikings landed, or the Norsemen landed, and went into, you know, they're walking into on the shore, and they're trying to go into the, you know, the woods, and that guy gets pelted with like 30,000 arrows.
I died laughing because I'm no, this is the second. What is going? No, that was the first episode. I'm like, yo, what is going on?
So he gets hit, right?
Yeah.
Who? Because we don't know who did it. Who do you think did it?
Still don't know.
Indigenous natives, because who was on the land? Because at the end of the day,
they never still got,
you know, we never found out. The other thing is, I'm thinking it ties into that episode where, you know, we see that old lady, you know, the lady and her kids going from one part of the country to the other part.
Mm-hmm.
I'm thinking it's them.
Could be.
I think go with that. There's all connected.
Yeah,
everything is connected. Like, all the coming, like, you know how, because what I also like is they didn't show Bill Keys necessarily, they didn't show a coming to America for Bill Keys till the end of the season. So that was how she got here. Who else? What are the god?
It's all connected. And I think and I don't think we're probably not going to figure some of that out until, like you said, season two.
Yeah.
How about this Zariah giving Shadow the moon? Like,
yeah, and that, and I got to be honest with you, that I'm like, this, that still hasn't played out yet to me.
Yeah.
That hasn't even
played
out.
That was mind-fucking, and he just wakes up like, is that a dream? I'm like, what do you think?
I don't know, but I think I'm going to play the check.
Right? Yeah, run it back, play again if I win.
Run it back.
I was happy you won. Like, you see, I think that those things happened to Shadow that were perfect because, again, for someone who doesn't believe, because Shadow didn't believe anything. He didn't believe any of it was real. So he's just like, fuck it, I'm just going to play. You're not really going to kill me. Your hammer isn't really bleeding. Like, none of this shit is real. Even I still believe that even after Chernabog said he was going to kill him, Shadow's like, yeah, fuck, this is bullshit. Like, he still didn't believe.
Oh, yeah, he was... It was amazing until Odin just pops up at the last episode. Because, like, I would say even then, you could tell during that Easter party when he actually talked to that Jesus dude that was floating on water and stuff. Like, yeah. He was inching towards me. I'm believing this now. Cause I just saw, like, 15 Jesuses as I come to this party. Like, okay.
And I would say that, too, because I think the Jesus he was approaching, that's the Jesus he always believed in. Which I got to say, really, Shadow Jesus?
White Jesus?
Right?
You believe a white Jesus? I would have seen a Jesus with dreadlocks. I wouldn't have been talking to him the whole time.
That's what I wanted to see. I'm not going to lie, but I wanted to see, like, dreadhead Jesus. Like, they didn't do that. Like, I'm like okay. We even saw, like, an Asian-looking Jesus. We saw Jesus.
Yeah, you saw Jesus. You ain't right.
Yeah. My bad.
Saw Asian Jesus, but I don't know which ethnicity of Asian he was. Cause I was like, man, Korean Jesus? I'm like, well, I don't know.
There was a brown Jesus over there, but I wasn't really sure what he was.
Nah, that was Jesus, bro. I mean, think about it. Yeah, that was. But as Wednesday said, everyone needs Jesus. So I don't think there's one white Jesus. I don't think there's one Asian Jesus. I think there's, like, Catholics will have their own Jesus. Protestants will have their own Jesus. Anglicans will have their own Jesus. So every denomination probably has their version of Jesus.
I do hope there's a storyline where they're, like, all connected in some type of weird way. But then again, if so, that's going to end up more sad than it is going to end up being inspiring. So I don't really hope it's done right.
It's like your black Jesus.
It would have been dope to see, like, you know, like Rasta Jesus just show up in there. Like, probably smoking pot. Like, fuck out of here. Like,
dude, they literally... I'm mad that we're treating Jesus like Eevee evolutions and shit now.
Hey, hold on. That's how man treats Jesus.
Okay, true. Yeah, you're right.
That's how we treat Jesus. Because black... Ask every black Christian. We got the same stance. You know Jesus was black. He wasn't a white man.
Yeah,
like we stand by that. We make sure to stand by that. You know, we do treat like Jesus like an Eevee evolution, man. We really do.
Yeah. It's just funny, but you know that's good. But thanks, Crosby. Thanks, Steve.
No, you're welcome, man.
Finally got this done.
We finally did this.
Did this and stuff. So yeah, it was finally checked off the list and stuff because some people asked us on Twitter like, "You guys going?" I was like, "You know what? Yeah, we probably should do that." So that's kind of like I was talking to a guy at BlurCon, and he listened to our show and stuff, and he was like, I was mentioning to him, like, yeah, there was some people asking us about Doctor Who, and I don't know, and he's like, I mean, if you guys can find somebody that knows about Doctor Who, all good podcast problems is people asking.
Here's me. That's the thing about it. Me and Chris don't care enough.
But we know a guy that cares enough, so it's like, okay, I get why. A season and then try to figure out how to go about this.
We got friends who are Whovians, but we don't give a crap, I guess.
So right.
Like, so it's like, how do we maneuver this? So we're still trying to figure that out. But American Gods,
I've been so lost in Doctor Who. I think after the Purple Man were doctors.
You're in the category as I was. I was watching it when Eccleston was there, and then Purple Man, and then after that, I was like, I kind of just lost track. I just didn't care.
Yeah, like, just a lot. It felt very repetitive.
Yeah.
I was like, yeah, I can't, you know, because, I mean, I really like Eccleston as Doctor Who.
Yeah.
And then when they changed him, I was like, okay, I could get with this guy. Yeah. It's pretty good, pretty brash. I just couldn't get with the other guys. I just couldn't do it.
Now, that being said, I know somebody's going to ask, like, what about Game of Thrones? And I watch Game of Thrones, but I'll be honest with you, we're probably not going to do that.
I was on board. You know what? I was on board, and I blame Netflix for this shit. They had seasons on Netflix, and then when Netflix got, when Game of Thrones got the HBO Go deal, they took the shit off.
Shit, I would too, to be honest with you.
It's Game of Thrones is, I believe, is so hard to do because it's,
there's a lot.
There are going to be so many opinions on it. And again, thinking gods is something you know, with Game of Thrones, you either you catch it in the beginning and talk about it then and keep going, or you just don't, because it's seven seasons in. If you're going to do one, you have to, you know, like, kind of catch people up and jump into the seventh season. I mean, so it's a lot.
When Game of Thrones has started off, I think we were still kind of early podcasting and stuff. Season two has started up when we started podcasting.
Maybe. Damn, I think
somewhere around there.
That long ago?
Yeah, that's how long ago. So it was like, hey. I think the idea of like Game of Thrones, me and D will occasionally talk about it because everybody on Twitter was just talking about all the ridiculous stuff in it. And it never clicked in our head to do it because I was like, well, but it was nothing that was like, I want a podcast about it. It was like,
And that's why I decided, you know, when American Gods started, I'm like, you know what? It's fresh. It's new. I'm going to jump on it. I'm going to, you know, get on it. And because I've always thought about doing a Game of Thrones one, but I'm like, dog, that's just so, that's like 60 or 70 years worth of.
Game of Thrones, I equated to people like me that watch One Piece from the beginning up till now. It's a commitment. It's either you either commit to it or you admit it.
And the thing about Game of Thrones is you can watch it if you've watched season one, because I had to watch it again because my girlfriend was watching it. I put her onto it, and so, you know, I was sitting down and watching her. We're watching it, and I'm seeing things happen, and I'm seeing things that, you know, when you watch it weekly and then you now watch it again, it's like, whoa, mm-hmm. I didn't see this. I don't remember this happening. I don't remember it like this. And so it's like, if you decide to not talk about it, it's being on for so long, I think you're going to miss certain things. And that's why I like, I'm not doing Game of Thrones. Yeah. But if you guys want to do Game of Thrones, I can jump on at some point. But I'm not going to do it.
Nah, that's going to be a lot of work. I mean, San Diego, we're actually going to do an episode on The Flash season 1-3 because we actually caught up on some stuff now. And I was like, hey, we got to do that in Arrow season 5 and shit. So, yeah, man.
I'll do Arrow season 5.
Yeah,
I'm not sure about The Flash. I don't like The Flash. I'm not too heavy on The Flash anymore.
You know what? And me and Chris will definitely get into that. Bam, we'll be giving it that. So, anyway, let's just wrap this up.
But anyways, American Gods, that's it. You know, you can listen to Crosby, the Earth 2 podcast. Was it Comic-Cast?
Yeah, Earth 2 Comic-Cast.
Earth 2 Comic-Cast. Check them out. They're on SoundCloud. Y'all on iTunes, right?
We're going on iTunes next month.
Okay. All right, so SoundCloud is probably basically where you can find them.
The best bet right now, yeah.
Yeah, so you already know where you find us at, Three Black Geeks. We're everywhere. We got San Diego Comic-Con coming up and lots of special stuff going down with that. Mm-hmm. So, we will catch you guys later. Peace out.
All right, thanks for having me.
All right.